The railway was closed in 1948. The closing of the railway, you could describe it as taking the lid off the Pandora box. The only thing that was left in the box was hope. And hope was always slow.
Everyone, I would say, nearly, that worked on that railway was fiddle players, lilters, swingers.
The scenery from Ballymafay to Glenties is rather spectacular, you know. It's rather nice. I always enjoyed that in the summertime.
Donegal men remember a railway which changed the lives of their community, changed the countryside, the leisure habits of the people, and the country's economy. It brought great benefits, freedom of travel to more distant markets, and it brought loss. In the 1840s, following the Great Famine, this quay was black with Donegal people forced to emigrate. Here, they said goodbye to their families. Few ever saw Ireland again. And it was emigration and the train that took my mother from her Irish home across the water to England. And it's the railway that's brought me back. I'm in the northwest of Ireland at the start of a journey on what was the longest narrow-gauge railway system in these islands. It ran from Ballyshannon and Killybegs in the south, north to Derry on the banks of the Foyle. I've always wanted to discover this branch line in particular. It ran from Stranorlar, the nerve centre of the County Donegal railway system, to the market town of Glenties in the Donegal Highlands. But before I do anything, I have to get to Stranorlar. That's why I'm here, in the Foyle Valley Railway Station, in the city of Derry, trying to hitch a lift. The local preservation society, one of three associated with the railway, have relayed a stretch of the line and rebuilt some of the old rail cars. Oh, by the way, who said childhood dreams don't come true?
Can you drive, Master?
You got a license? Which way's the front? Where am I?
Have you got a license, Master?
I've got a fishing license, that'll do. It's Hal.
What's your name?
I'd like to get out of this in a rush.
Okay.
Great.
Ian.
I'm in. Oh, wow, that's good.
That's grand.
Well, what do I do next?
Let's see how we start it. This is the isolating switch for your electric.
Yeah.
So put that on.
Put it on.
Switch on. Right.
Great.
Getting it to go should be child's play. But if it isn't, I have Tom here to help. He spent his life on the railways and enjoys driving the old rail cars in his spare time. Okay.
So we'll let those sit for a wee minute. Press your button. Now that's your accelerator. Okay.
Yep.
Foot's down and out of first gear. Two signals to the other train. And away you go.
Oh, thank you.
And away you go.
And off I go.
Yep, nice and easy.
Oh, yes.
Straight down and under second.
Should I change?
Yeah. Take a right back.
Second back to first.
Not quite as smooth as my GTI.
Well, thanks very much for that moment of humiliation, Tommy.
Nice one.
Big profits were there if it was your land that the railways needed. Along here, a hard bargain was struck.
There was an old pensioner up there, and she lived right on the corner. The difficulty we had was getting the railway line around the back of the house. And the only thing we could do was go to the lady and talk to her about her washing line. And her washing line was blocking the railway. And she thought for a while, these guys are winding me up or something, you know. But we convinced her anyway that if she let us move her washing line, we could get the railway past the houses. So the deal was that we would reinstate the washing line, put her on a nice wee pathway and all the rest of it, which we duly did.
And
hence the railway's past the...
So that's the washing line, that's coming across here before.
That's the famous washing line. And you can see the new bit of fencing there.
Yes. That's the bit of washing line that was standing in the way of the railway.
That stopped the railway.
The surrounding country is rough and rugged, the mountains high, the gradient steep. Not exactly ideal when you're building a railway. So, a narrow gauge line was chosen instead of a broad gauge one. By 1889, the railway reached Donegal town. Inevitably, when the trains came, things changed.
It was one of the greatest things ever happened to a society. It was like, in its day, you were looking at a position whereby you would take, say, a horse and cart from Stranorlar to Donegal town at 4 miles an hour over very bad roads, carrying like half a ton of goods. And suddenly overnight, you had a train bringing 100 tons on a smooth rail at 20 miles an hour. That was a massive movement in transport systems. That increased the economic development of Donegal, but on the other hand, it actually accelerated emigration. People could get away to Derry far cheaper than they could in the past to the boat for America.
What's this story about the hens?
The station master had, because he had such a large family and he could out one way or another, he kept hens. And the hens used to feed off the grain wagons that would come in underneath them. And what they would do was, at night they would actually perch on the axles of the wagon. And then in the morning the wagons would go out early, probably before light, but even not, because hens will actually not move if a machine is moving. They'll sit there. And they would go the whole way to Ballyshannon. And they get off of Ballyshannon, feed round there. The station master would then put them back in the wagon and send them back here. And sometimes they actually didn't get back here. They'd bypass here and go on to Derry. And the station master in Derry would know who owned them, and he would put them back in and send them back. And I'm sure everyone got their share of eggs, you know, one way or another, out of the whole thing.
This first-class collection of models of the trains, once a common sight trundling across the country, is part of a large collection of photographs, posters and mementos kept in the old Donegal station house. Sometimes the daily routines of the railway had unexpected results.
The only trouble I had was one day I was asked to take a rail car through to Stranorlar. And they landed at Stranorlar anyway, and when we were ready to come back in the evening into Donegal, this man got in to the back seat. I asked this gentleman for his ticket, and he said he hadn't got one. I asked him if he had a pass, and he said he hadn't got one. So I said to him that, you know, they're not supposed to travel in the rail car without a ticket. So he says, I'm the manager. So I asked him, what is the manager of? And he said, the company. So I said, all right, I said, I'll have your name and address. Oh, so I took his name and address. Sent off a letter on here from about this gentleman maintaining that he was manager travelling the 7:10 rail car next to Northern such and such evening. I was porter on the platform here at the time. So on Friday evening I got a letter from Northern to say it's on Monday morning, there's a point of check in the store. So that was the result of me reporting the manager, but not by travelling without a ticket or a pass.
So he was the manager?
He was the manager. He was the manager.
No trace is left of the once busy Stranorlar station or of this impressive bridge. It's a pity they didn't keep it as a monument to the railway. But it was the starting place of one of the remotest Donegal lines. Opened in 1895, the line to Glenties skirted the turbulent River Finn for 27 miles. The first stop up the valley is Glenmore. The land was given to General Sir Charles Stiles by the Crown in recognition of his services in the wars against Napoleon. He thought it was the most beautiful place in the world. He built the house and planted trees, attempting to recreate with them his troop positions at Waterloo. Clochan is just a few miles along the river. To here, the railway brought fishermen in search of the fabled salmon leap. Only this sturdy bridge pier stands firm against the force of the river. General Stiles was a passionate fisherman. He built Clarke and Lodge to entertain his sporting friends. Stiles was a good landlord. He gave back the land to its original owners, and he looked after the poor. During the famine years, he built this little broth house here out of stone, and he'd send servants out with a tureen of soup and bar them in with an iron gate to stop them being attacked, and they'd serve out bowls of broth through this little hole in the wall. The trains have gone, the tracks reclaimed by nature, but the railway still lives in the memories of the Finn Valley people.
The stories told about this railway. I knew a man myself when I was young that worked on it, but he was telling us that there was women worked as well as men, and it was during the famine times. And he said that more or less it was given work to people during the famine times. And I often heard him saying the wages the women got breaking stones was 4 old pence. That was the old money going that a day. And I think, as far as I know, it was a long day. But the heaps of stones are still up on the wee glen that the women broke for that railway, here and there. But there was a very nice air that was always played in this part of the country. This air, it went with a song that was composed by this man. And he composed it over a fella that had to emigrate to Van Diemen's land from the Glen of Glenties, and he was never to come back. And the name of the song was, in the Irish language, Ta Glanbag Raivin in Éirinn, or There's a Lovely Glen in Ireland.
Ballinamore, a lonely monument to the age of steam in a wild and desolate land. The land is alive with the stories of heroes and saints.
Columkill was the saint of the area. He prophesied that in the time to come, a black pig would come along this area here, which would be through the Finn Valley, and the people would be all welcoming this black pig. They didn't know what the black pig was. About 1890, a new Conservative government was set up in England. So the secretary that was then appointed to Ireland was Lord Balfour. Lord Balfour made a special circle of the congested, the poor areas of Ireland, here and there, to see what help he could give them. And their destination was Glenties here. And they brought Lord Balfour into the hotel. Other places, they threw stones in, but they brought him into the hotel, and the best meal in the house was put before him, and for drinking part of it, if he was going to be there till 12 o'clock, the glass would be always full. But he couldn't refuse. He had to do something. He said he would give them a railway. And they had the train working. They had the train running in 7 years. The first train ran from Stranorlar to Glenties. A date early in June, that was the first train. And this train was the black pig of the area.
But like most remote Irish railways, the The County Donegal line found it hard to pay its way. It needed men of courage and determination to make it work. B.L. Curran was the last general manager of the line. His son, Joe, takes a keen interest in its history.
Any railway that could run three steam trains in each direction each day in 1894, well, that was quite something. And if you noticed from the old timetables that the first train out of Stranorlar in the morning was described as third class only and was largely a mail train. So you see, the railway was not only carrying people, it was carrying various other things like potatoes and wool and livestock and mails. And these things dovetailed, believe it or not, into other seasonal traffics, such as the tourists, so there weren't so much tourists then. But there were lovely tourist bills, lovely tourists, and there's one in this museum showing that Donegal was unspoiled and these beauty spots could be opened by travelling by rail, particularly from Derry to Portneau. Portneau is just a few miles from here. And certainly there was a lot of traffic, and there was the local traffic. There were the people going to church. It was the only way they had it going. I remember well as a boy, little rail car services stopping outside the church at Ballandoon to let the people off the bridge to cross to church. They used to say to stop at the double gates, please let me off at Ballandoon Bridge. And we knew where they were going, we were going to church. And keep an eye for me coming up again, won't you? Because by that time, Mass would be over and the next train would be coming up.
The railway produced its own personalities. The most remarkable was Henry Forbes, who became general manager in 1910. His vision and ingenuity are vividly remembered.
Henry Forbes was a very practical man. He was guided by two motivations. One of them was to run everything as cheaply as possible, and secondly, to give the customer the best possible value. But in addition to that, he was a great man to save money, and he was ingenious. He saved money, for instance, in the workshops, which were a considerable place. There were great big notices around, material is money, save it. Or just other simple notice, think. So he had these sort of things, and he had this sort of aura about him for saving. And he was respected, but certainly feared by his staff. And he was very brave. If you read the article which Des Fitzgerald has written about his bravery on a train at Ballantra on the Ballyshannon to Donegal line, where the train was held up by the IRA, and he ordered the train driver at gunpoint to proceed, or he would drive it himself. And when a shot was fired or something of that nature, he pursued the gunmen through the fields and chased them himself. So he was brave as well as enigmatic, but he was also a great engineering man. He was a great man to not only make do in men, but to experiment. And way back as far as the 20s, he was experimenting with petrol rail cars. And about 1920, 21, he instituted petrol rail cars on the County Donegal Railways. And that, more than any other thing, that experimentation was the reason why the County Donegal survived another 40 years. And then he began to experiment with diesel. And he got diesel engines put into these rail cars, six-cylinder Gardner diesel engines. And these continued right up to the end. And the County Donegal Railways, which was the biggest narrow gauge railway in the British Isles, was also the first in the world to use diesel traction on rail. So he had a lot of credits.
Nostalgia for the early railways is fairly common today. For the travellers themselves, nostalgia is coloured by reality.
Travelling by train then wasn't a luxurious way of travelling, because especially the railway from Strabane to Glenties, they had no heating in the carriages. And in the winter time, coming home at Christmas, you were like an icicle by the time you reached Glenties. And then there were such delays at stations. A border was a problem then. It was always at least a half an hour searching the train at Castlefin, it was on the way in. On the way out, it was at Strabane. And there was a lot of delays. It took 2 good hours and more to get from Strabane to Glenties, which isn't any more than about 40 miles. No. So that, as I say, it was a rather adventurous journey every time, and anything but comfort.
So there were no extra facilities on the train, no buffet cars?
Well, the buffet cars were on the main GNR line from Belfast to Derry. But after that, you starved until you got home. You were usually very glad to see the end of the railway line in Glenties. However, I must say in the summertime, it was a pleasant journey when you weren't being frozen, you see. Because the scenery from certainly Ballymafay to Glenties is rather spectacular, you know. It's rather nice. I always enjoyed that in the summertime. It's the winter time that I've unfortunately remember most about, because I used to be so uncomfortable when I'd get home.
There are cars in Glenties today. Apart from that, little has changed. Its great market drew people from all over Donegal.
The fairs in Glenties were mainly cattle and sheep. Now, it was mostly cattle fairs except two or three times in the year. The harvest fair, which is the 12th of September. That was the big sheep fair, often the 12th of October. But mainly, Glenties was cattle fair. They had a cow market, what they called a cow market, just up above the barracks there. And that all the farmers would bring in whatever stock they had for sale there. The buyers came and bought these cattle. They drove them down to the station, put them on, and took them off.
The west of Ireland inspired artists from Yeats to Brian Friel. Glenties had its own fine poet, Patrick McGill. His work still stands high in the ranks of Irish literature.
As a young child, practically, McGill went to work with a farmer in County Tyrone. And he has written two books about it, The Children of the Dead End and The Rat Pit, which is really autobiographical. The hardships that he endured there were dreadful. Ultimately, as he grew up, he went, like so many of his compatriots, went across to Scotland. And he worked there as a navvy on railways. They were building railways in Scotland at the time. And he had a natural ability in the use of words. I think he got a job as a reporter, and he began to get articles published. And these articles drew attention of the literary types in London to his ability. And he began to turn out books, and he wrote some marvellous poetry. And he kept on at that until the First World War. Then he joined up and he went out with the British Expeditionary Force. When he came back, he ultimately gravitated to Hollywood to write scripts for films which were coming on at the time, and he ultimately died in America.
When the gossamer is shining and the moorland blossoms bloom, I'll take the road across the hills I tramped so long ago. It's far I am beyond the seas, but yearning voices call. Will you not come back to Glenties and your wave-washed Donegal?
The last passenger train left Fintan Station in 1947. Now, the local communities come together to rebuild the railway on the banks of Loch Fyn. Oddly, the carriages are from Belgium.
Can I give you a hand with that? You don't look like you need it very much, but fresh pair of arms.
Off you go.
Where do I go?
Railways need strong men to build them.
We have to load the sleepers by hand, and we have to load our rail by hand. And the rails are our 60-foot rail. It's 3/4 of a ton, and our 40-foot rail is 1/2 a ton. So it's with plenty of manpower and plenty of good workers here that gets us where we are today. Everything is done here by hand. We had no machinery. We had less machinery at the very beginning. We had nothing at all until we got this shunter here. We would lay two panels in a day if we had the material. Well, that's it, if we have the gravel up the day before, we can lay two panels in a day.
3 tons of rail?
Yeah, it's up on 3 tons of rail, yeah, laid in a day. It is very heavy work, there's no doubt about it. I suppose there's nobody else who'd be at it, only Donegal ones up here in Fintown. And in a few years' time, we hope to be in Glenties.
And do you think you'll see a steam engine panting up the valley again?
Steam engine will come, providing we get... We need money. Funding is our biggest problem. I mean, we do need money. We can't go on without getting the money from the various bodies that's out there to help us. It may be slow, but it will come. It will come.